Well, aren't you guys all the lucky ones? Right? Coming out early to the concert so you could learn a little something. I personally love pre-concert lectures. I think they're really fun because, and I like it when conductors talk too, because a lot of times we don't always know what we're listening for unless people are telling us what to listen for. And it's not even as much about that, but getting to know the backgrounds and historically what's going on and what this is all about is pretty important, and it's really fun. So this concert is, as if you saw the posters and all that, this is kind of the 150th birthday for Ralph Vaughan Williams. Yay, happy birthday, Ralph. Actually, his birthday's not till October 12th, so it's not quite his birthday yet, but there will be lots of concerts featuring Ralph Vaughan Williams music this year because of that. We like to have some direction in how we program things. So birthdays and other anniversaries are always really fun. So when I saw it was Ralph Vaughan Williams' 150th year, I thought that would be a really great excuse to do some really beautiful music. Because if there's one thing I know about Ralph Vaughan Williams' music is that I really love how lush and beautiful it is. He was writing this really wonderful, very tonal and beautiful music in the midst of some real craziness that was going on in the rest of the musical world. So that's just something to think about. So the greater context, though. So Ralph Vaughan Williams born in 1872. So here we are. It's we're in the midst of the of what we call now the Romantic era in music, and a lot happened during that time. A lot happened during that whole period. And that's a fun song. Now I'm distracted. Now I have no idea what I was talking about. No. So in that period, a lot of really neat things happening. Some of the most potent composers that were influencing a lot were people like Wagner and Brahms and a lot of other Germans. They were the big heavy hitters. And also some opera composers like Verdi and all that. So he's born into this time. But the late 1800s, those last couple centuries of the 1800s, was a real period that we think about. We talk about it being a period of nationalism. And we talk about musical nationalism a lot because it's at the end of the era there. Around 1870, Italy and Germany both finally unify as countries for the first time because they've been just city-state collections for centuries before that. And there's nationalistic fervor kind of all throughout Europe. And a lot of people are exploring the folk songs of different people groups, especially those people groups that are part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire that didn't have their own countries because they were ruled over by some other people. So there was a lot of exploration in the nationalistic stuff. And the same was going on in England right here in about 1872. It had been almost 200 years since Henry Purcell died. And that's significant because Henry Purcell was the last English composer in the 1690s. He was the last English composer of an international reputation. He was the last one that actually exerted, and we talk about a reputation like that, not just that people liked his music, but his music influenced other composers in the generations to follow. He was the last British, natural-born British composer to have an international reputation. And for the next 200 years, the British people kind of thought, oh, we gotta find a new national hero of British music. And they tried importing people and their favorite composers like Handel. Handel actually did become a British citizen in the mid-1700s, but he was German, too. He wasn't a natural-born British composer. The next composer to come to England and have this wonderful reputation and everybody loved him was Haydn from Austria. Great, right? And then the next big composer comes along in the 1830s, and it's Mendelssohn. Another German. So the British had this long history of importing their favorite composers, but they didn't have their own. And so there was this real soul-searching in the late 1800s. And they thought for a while it was going to be Arthur Sullivan that was going to be that guy to take up the mantle of British music. But then he needed, the side story, yeah, he really needed money. So he hooked up with this Gilbert fellow over here and wrote operettas for the rest of his life. So instead of being the great British national composer that everyone thought he was going to be, he became an operetta composer. We like it, and we're glad that Sullivan did that, but we were still looking for our great national British hero. And then in a way, in this next generation, right about 1900, Edward Elgar finally did kind of take on that mantle of being a composer of import in the rest of the world. But, okay, so this is kind of the world, the musical world that Vaughan Williams is born into. When he's about 10 years old, the England founds the Royal Conservatory of Music. And one of the things that the first two directors of that, Perry and Stanford, one thing they really want to do is explore this idea of what is a British sound? What is British music? What is it really? And so that's part of the that's part of the whole discussion. And so Ray Vaughan Williams, who studied some music as a child, he enrolls in the Royal College of Music, or Royal Conservatory of Music, and he studies there for a couple years and some other places, and he becomes a fine young composer. In that time, he also he got into that discussion. He befriended Gustav Holst, who you've noticed is on the program too. Gustav Holst, they met in 1895 at the Royal Conservatory, and they were lifelong friends after that. And they were also both very deeply involved in this discussion of what is British music? What does it sound like? And what is it? And so Gustav Holst and Ray Vaughan Williams, right around from like 1895 through the first few years of the 1900s, they spent a lot of time combing the British countryside for folk songs. And collected over 800 of them. Vaughan Williams himself collected over 800 folk songs, got them written down. You had to go and listen to these old guys down by the docks on the seacoast there and have them sing their sea shanty in your ear. You try to write it down, or you use your really, really early like wax cylinders to try to record these people. It was kind of fun. They would like being these musical archaeologists. So that influenced Vaughan Williams collecting and singing and hearing all of these British folk songs from all over the Isles, and it influenced Holst as well, and they both ended up using folk songs in their music. So these folk song arrangements, some of the early works of Vaughan Williams and Holst, one thing that distinguishes both of them is that a lot of composers are of one category or another, but people like Vaughan Williams wrote for the lowliest, you know, people to sing on the street, and for the grandest of concert halls, and everything in between. So he was deep into folk music and the music of the people, and he edited the English hymnal at the time in the first few years of the 1900s, and wrote some of his own hymns and all that. And he was also writing symphonies and large choral orchestral works for the concert hall. And so some of the most loved music of Vaughan Williams that we remember right away are some of his folk song arrangements. We're not going to sing this one today, but I want to just play a little bit of one. Where'd it go? Yes. Bear with me. So that is beautiful, right? But not musically explorative or anything, really. It's very standard in the way that it's written, but it's just done in a really, really nice way. And Vaughan Williams and Holst both wrote a number of these folk song arrangements, and we sing them all the time. But at the same time, Vaughan Williams was becoming a serious composer of concert music, of music for symphonies and all of that. And he felt a little insecure in his technique throughout his 20s and his early 30s. And he ended up studying with some people. One of the people he ended up studying with was Maurice Ravel. And Ravel is a very important French composer of the time, right there in the first few years of the 1900s. And Ravel did, we hear after he studies with Ravel, we hear Vaughan Williams' mature sound come out. One of the things those lessons did was rid his music of some of the over heavy-handed Germanic kind of sound and gave him some of the light, lyrical, and colorful French sounds of the time. And so that shaped his sound just a little bit, and he started writing things like this. Oh, this is his serenade to music. We're not playing this today, sadly. It would be fine. But so this piece just gives you some of the lush, colorful instrumentation that Vaughan Williams adopted and started to use. And I'll just pause that for a second. And we have to remember, this is in the context, that this is the same time that people like Schoenberg are experimenting with atonality and things like that. And Strauss is writing some of his crazy super chromatic stuff. And all of the German musical language is going towards this extremely, almost chaotic atonality. And Vaughan Williams is writing music like this and continues to write music like this through the rest of his career. And it's really, really wonderful. So that's kind of his mature sound, but others, the Germanic influence was leaving. And then after World War I, there would be a distinct swing away from Germanic influences in music all over Europe. Are we surprised? Maybe not. Anyway, so the other thing about Vaughan Williams and Holst and Ravel and these people that are all on the concert today is that these men, their compositional careers were greatly affected by the fact that they encompassed both world wars and the time between the wars, which was a strange time as well, musically. And so this actually affects everything about them. So this World War I comes up in 1914, and as we put this program together, all but one of the pieces on the program were written either right around or right before World War I or right before World War II. And that kind of became the thing of the concert. Now, I chose to do Dona Nobis Pacem. We didn't confirm it until, you know, a few months ago, but I thought about doing this piece already, like, last May. We did not realize that it would be such an appropriate thing to be singing and playing at this time in the history of the world. And we hope that things calm down, because Vaughan Williams wrote this piece, Dona Nobis Pacem. He wrote it in 1936, right before World War II started, when tensions were high. And it was not, it looked like it could go bad, and it did. We'll get to that in a minute. But in a way, all of these pieces that we hear today are affected by that idea of the world wars. So yes, this concert, it's his 150th birthday, Dona Nobis Pacem. I really wanted to play on the concert. And now we filled out the concert with music from other people. We'll just walk through a few of these pieces and give you a little idea of what they're like. So, not all the pieces, I hope you got a program, not all the pieces on the concert are by Vaughan Williams, but I figured it was his birthday party, right? So we could invite his best friends. Right? I think that's a good plan. It doesn't have to just be about him, right? But the first piece on the program is The Lark Ascending. And this is one of Vaughan Williams' most well-known works, most frequently performed in the orchestral world. And this comes out of the tradition, and the way it fits with the wars and all that is, this is one of the very last things that Vaughan Williams wrote before World War I broke out. And then he went to war and drove ambulances. Vaughan Williams was 42 when World War I broke out, so he wasn't of the age yet where he was going to go to front lines or anything, but he ended up driving ambulances, so he did have a front row seat to some of the most horrible things in the war. But right before the war, he wrote The Lark Ascending, and he wasn't quite happy with it, ready to have it premiered, but then he was busy for a few years. When he came back from the war, it was one of the first pieces that he picked back up again, finished and edited and cleaned up and premiered. In 1920, and it's become one of his most famous pieces. Now, this comes out of the Romantic era tradition of pieces that are painting pictures, program music. The Lark Ascending is about a lark flying around, and it's inspired by a poetry here, and the poetry is there on page 3 in the program. You can see the poetry. It doesn't show up in the piece at all, but it is in the score so that you can know what he was inspired by. So I provided it for you there so you can see that. Sorry, I got all squished when it got printed. But a little thing about the lark there. He rises and begins to round. He drops the silver chain of sound of many links without a break in chirrup, whistle, slur, and shake for singing till his heaven fills. 'Tis love of earth that he instills. So it's a picture of a lark. And so The Lark is played by a solo violin. My Anna Merchant is going to play that. It's just absolutely beautiful. And The Lark sings songs and flits around and flies through the sky, and you can just follow it around while the orchestra is providing this wonderful little bed of sound for the lark to fly above. So it's a little piece of program music. I'll play just a little bit of that. So of course we'll get to hear all the rest of that later on, but it keeps unfolding out of that. And you can hear the bird flying right away. You only need to hear you need to see the title of the piece and hear that, and you can see what was in Vaughan Williams' mind at that point. It's very cool. The next piece on the program is another piece that kind of represents something about Vaughan Williams, and also something very British and very English. Another thing that was going on in this search for a British sound. There are other places that the British looked for those sounds as well, and one of those places was in the tradition of the English madrigal back in the late 1500s, early 1600s. And so a lot of composers were writing in that style in a way. They were writing in that style and trying to recapture some of the beauty of that music. And one thing that the music of that time, English madrigals, is they tried to paint pictures with the words and paint pictures with the sounds. And also that it's linked up, this next piece is linked up with the fact that the traditions that the British had, is one of them is they really loved amateur choirs. They loved getting together and singing, and they still do. But choral societies and choral festivals and all that. And this is the kind of music written for them. So Rest is a part song and a text by Christina Rossetti, a very famous British poet. So it's very, very British in so many ways. And it's kind of written in an updated Romantic era style like that of the Renaissance in a little bit. So I won't go into that anymore. You'll have to listen to that. That's an a cappella piece. The chamber singers will sing that, and it's really, really quite beautiful. You can see that it's not about war, but it is about death. So it fits, right? I hope so. But very, very beautiful. Now you already know, I already talked about Ravel a little bit, but that's why Ravel shows up on a program of British music, these pieces by Maurice Ravel. And actually, this is going to be sung by Triple C, the contemporary singers, these two pieces. It is trois chansons, so it is three songs, but we're only doing two of them. And they're quite wonderful. Now, these relate to the theme also, because these pieces Maurice Ravel wrote when he was specifically thinking about World War I. Because these are the pieces that he wrote. The only a cappella choral music he ever wrote were these three pieces. And he wrote them while he was waiting to get called up to go and fight in World War I. He knew he was going to be called up, it was just when, and this is what he wrote while he was waiting. And so these poems, the first song there, Trois beaux oiseaux du paradis, this first song is specifically about war. You can see three lovely birds from paradise, and then this refrain keeps coming back on, my beloved is to the fighting gone. Three lovely birds from paradise come and visit this, we assume, this young lady whose love has gone to war. And then at the end, it says, ye lovely birds from paradise. At the end, it says, the third bird, there's three that show up, one blue, one white, and one red to represent the French flag. And the last one, the red one, shows up. And the bird says, I bring you a faithful heart all crimson red. And with that, she assumes that her love has died and her heart grows cold. So it's kind of a sad. Now the music that accompanies this is Ravel writing in the great old French chanson tradition of the 1500s, where the music is very evocative of the text. It paints little pictures. And so that little refrain, "My love is to the war gone," or to the fighting gone, that refrain has the same musical figure each time it shows up. And the underneath it all is a really quite haunting sort of sound. It's unsettled in the way that it feels like it's pretty solidly in the key, but doesn't sound like it. It has a lot of jazz harmonies in it, actually, which is why it was a good choice for Triple C to sing. A lot of very delicate harmonies, but because it's a delicate story, it's matched with some delicate and haunting and sad music. The other of the two chanson that we're bringing to you is called Nicolette, and you can see the translation in your program there. It tells the story of a young girl who's poorly supervised. And she's going skipping around through the forest, and she meets a gray wolf, wisely runs away. She is approached by a young page, and and she slinks away because she's like, thanks, but no thanks. But then a really ugly, nasty old man comes and offers her some gold. And she runs into his arms and is never seen again. Bad story there. Not smart. So anyway, it's an uplifting story, of course. But anyway, these are really wonderful things. But do keep your program out and read that text along while they're singing the song, because phrase to phrase, it's pretty drastically different, right? Painting when she runs away, we sing really fast. And when she's talking to the page, the tenors are singing in high falsetto because they are the little boy. Keep your program out. I'll tell everybody that in the concert too, because it'll make a lot more sense if you are watching the words as you go on. The last piece of the first half is we did bring Holst into the party. And Holst, this is a good example of the way Holst and Vaughan Williams folded folk song into their music, the St. Paul Suite. Also one of the very last pieces that Holst wrote before he went off to go fight in World War I. This has become one of his most popular pieces for a string orchestra, but he wrote others that are very well known. Probably The Planets, his suite of symphonic poems, The Planets, is probably the most well-known of his. He's also very, very well-known for writing some of the first classics of the concert wind band repertoire, because that concert bands were a pretty new, kind of a new thing around 1900, and they played a lot of orchestral arrangements and reductions, but not, they didn't have much music written for their own. And so Holst, you may know a couple of these pieces. I'll just play the first little bit of his second suite in F major for band. A little bit of that. All right, that's one. I had a lot of fun playing that one when I was in college. I think the college band here played it recently. I can't remember. They did first suite, but this is second suite. And the reason I bring up second suite is the last movement of that. The last movement of the second suite for military band, it's called Fantasia on the Dargason. The Dargason is a specific melody that you can hear, and Holst took that out of that suite and reworked it for string orchestra, and it is what they play for the final movement of the St. Paul suite. Here's what it sounds like in the band piece. I won't give it all away. You get to listen to the orchestra play that later, and it's very fun. But that's the Dargason. What a fun melody, yeah? And so he used that as the source for his piece there. Okay, so coming lastly to Dona Nobis Pacem, the second half of the program. Dona Nobis Pacem is his Vaughan Williams plea for peace that he wrote during 1936. A lot of crazy things going on in 1936. England started the year with a new king in January, and that king would abdicate the throne by the end of the year. It was kind of chaotic there. He wrote this piece, he was probably finishing it up during the Berlin Olympics in 1936. That took place in August. the world was a tense place in 1936. I wasn't there, but I hear it was. And if you read the facts of what was going on, yes, it was a tense place, and it was on the precipice of war. It really was, of a world war. Or, as I often say, the continuation of World War I, right? That's really what World War II was. And so this interwar period was difficult. And so Vaughan Williams was not a pacifist. He was not like Britain, who would write the War Requiem after World War II was over. He was an avowed pacifist. But Vaughan Williams wrote this plea for peace to say, we don't, you know, war is horrible. Let's not do this. And here's a piece to tell us why. And to do it, he went back to a poet that he'd written quite a bit on before, or written music with quite a bit before, Walt Whitman. He took poems that Walt Whitman wrote, reflecting on the horrors of the Civil War, the American Civil War, and he used those in this piece. And you can see all the texts there in your program, and I encourage you to follow along when we're actually performing the piece. Now, the piece is about 35 minutes long, and it is in 6 movements, but the movements go without pause. There is no stop, there's no pause between the movements. So as you're listening to it, you'll notice that. And something that Vaughan Williams did here, which became more popular, but it was pretty novel at the time, was to take the Latin text of the Agnus Dei, which you'll hear at the beginning, and fold that in with a bunch of other English texts. And that's exactly what, to an even larger degree, what Benjamin Britten would do with the War Requiem in 1961, in that same kind of model, in a piece about 4 times the size. But this particular piece, the Whitman texts and a few other texts are folded into this. And you can see how they're arranged in the movements there. The first movement is Agnus Dei, grant us peace. It's done with the choir and a soprano solo. And Veronica Turner's going to sing our soprano solo. She's back there. She's doing such a beautiful job. But the soprano solo, their job is to come and just be really dejectedly sad and loud about it. Yeah, so you'll hear that plea for peace, quite impassioned plea for peace happening over and over again every time the soprano shows up. In between that, we get some really interesting pictures of war. And the first is the second movement, the Walt Whitman text, Beat, Beat Drums, which you can see it there. Beat, beat drums, blow, bugles blow. Through the windows, through the doors, burst like a ruthless force. Into the solemn church and scatter the congregation. Into the school where the scholar is studying. Leave not the bridegroom quiet. No happiness must he have now with his bride, nor the peaceful farmer any peace, plowing his field or gathering in his grain. So fierce you whir and pound, you drums, so shrill you bugles blow. So this is delivered by the choir and orchestra with a pretty militaristic kind of sound, pretty pictorial of the language. The bugles blow, and you'll hear the bum bum ba da dum ba da dum. It's over and over again. I can play just a little bit of the beginning of that one. Got a few minutes here. That's how it begins. Here come the drums and the bugles and all that. And that movement is almost entirely like that. The third movement transitions into kind of a more reflective mood, and you can see the text. Word over all, beautiful as the sky, also Walt Whitman, beautiful that war and all its deeds of carnage must in time be utterly lost, that the hands of the sisters death and night incessantly softly wash again and ever again this soiled world. So death and night is like the war happens, it keeps getting reset, and then it happens again, but death and night softly wash away all of this soiled world. So, and this is delivered, that text is first delivered to us by our baritone soloist. Cameron is actually back here, he's listening here. And so Cameron and Ronnie are our 2 adjunct voice faculty here at the college. They teach all of our voice students. I teach some, but not if I can get away with it, because they're better than I am. So, and so we hear it first with the baritone solo, and then the choir sings it as well. That's a really, really beautiful. And I'm not going to play some of that, because I want you to be surprised at how really beautiful it is. So, and then we turn to the fourth movement, which is the fourth movement was actually mostly written earlier, before World War I. It's a setting of a dirge for two veterans by Walt Whitman. And you can see, this tells the story, this poem tells the story of a father and a son who have both died in war together, and they're about to be buried. And the so you can see that the there's a sad procession, there are bugles, they're getting these military honors, and the march comes along, but it's not a happy march. It's a very sad march. And there's some reflective moments in there where the night falls a little bit, and you can hear that the strings play these wonderful triplet things. But all through that movement, you can feel the march going on. And so that's another Walt Whitman text there. That turns to movement five. Then things start getting biblical here. Movement five, the baritone solo comes back and talks about the angel of death, and this is from a speech by John Bright. The angel of death has been abroad throughout the land. You may almost hear the beating of his wings. There's no one as of old to sprinkle with blood the lintel and the two side posts of our doors, that he may spare and pass on. That must have been something that resonated a lot with the people of 1936, right? That you could just feel this coming darkness, like you can't escape it. Which is why it turns again to a plea of Dona Nobis Pacem. We sing about that a little bit. And then we start hearing some prophecy and some turning to texts mostly from the Old Testament. In movement five, the choir sings, we looked for peace, but no good came. And for a time of health, and behold, trouble. The snorting of his horses was heard from Dan. The whole land trembled at the sound of the neighing of his strong ones, for they are come and have devoured the land and those that dwell therein. I was telling the choir, I told them a couple times, we talked about this even last night in rehearsal, about how because they're close to us, the world wars seem like a novelty. But if you look at the history of the world, and this just shows you, from a prophet writing 2,500 years ago, we're struggling with the same things, right? The war is still on our doorstep all the time. And talked about how the experience of the people writing these things, if you would read the histories of the people there in Jeremiah, or read in 1st and 2nd Kings, war was really, really horrible then, in a way that we can't even imagine. And yes, so this kind of gets a picture of that a little bit. Then after all of that depressing stuff, there is redemption at the end, because movement six opens with some prophecy looking beyond all the war and toward the end of things, when war will be no more. And that's what movement six is all about. You can see that the text is taken from a whole bunch of different places and strung together there. But the overwhelming theme of that text is that someday that will all be over. Someday that will all be over. And it says, "For as the new heavens and the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, so shall your seed and your name remain forever," from Isaiah. "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." And the whole piece ends very triumphantly for a time, because then it returns back to 1936 and says, we're still where we are right now, even if we can look to the future and see something better. So you'll hear the end there. It's a really beautiful piece of music, a wonderful emotional journey, and I'm really looking forward to sharing that with you today. But boy, we should probably wrap this up here, because I got singers to go wrangle. But anyway, I'm really glad you came. I love Music of the Masters. I hope you come every year, and I like doing these pre-concert lectures, because this concert of all has has a theme and is serious music that we close the year out with here. And it's fun to talk about those great composers and their great works. So we really hope you enjoy Ray Vaughan Williams' 150th birthday. Today, we're going to enjoy providing the music for you, and we hope you love it. So thanks.
Good afternoon, and welcome to our annual Music of the Masters concert. My name is Jennifer DiPaolo. I direct the orchestra here and teach violin. This is my colleague, Dr. Zach Vreeman, who is our choral conductor. We'd like to first thank you so much for being here. And this musical journey for this concert is always such a treat to end our school year. We rehearse the ensemble separately, get them together, bring in some special guests, and thank you so much for doing that, and rehearse for an entire day, practically, to put it together. We were here yesterday for a while, and we needed to get it really solid. Those relationships are so important, and the relationship we have with the music, with everybody on stage, with you, the audience, and there's a special relationship that is changing this year. And I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge Dr. Eric Unruh. If you could come up here, please. I'm going to try not to get too emotional, but this is a very special relationship, and I probably wouldn't be here if it wasn't for this gentleman. He's in charge of hiring a lot of us here, so it's your fault. And essentially, this beautiful facility is also about the relationships that Dr. Unruh forged here at the college for decades. He's been a part of the campus community. How many years? 33. I wasn't. He's touched so many of us, so many piano students over the years, so many faculty and music students, theater students. He had been an active member of our musical theater community for years. The list goes on and on and on. And without him, this building and this hall wouldn't be here. So we have accredited programs because of him. He is nationally renowned and on our National Association School of Music's advisory committees, has served in various roles there. He's gotten me involved in that personally, and it's very gratifying work to be a part of that association. And I can't thank you enough. We can't thank you enough for all the work you've done. And we dedicate this concert to you, so. So Anna Merchant is our soloist for The Lark Ascending. This is her last semester. She's graduating with an occupational therapy assistant degree and is going out to do great things in our community with occupational therapy, and I bet some music sprinkled in because it's in her soul. So please welcome to the stage Anna Merchant.
do want to say something really quick about these before we sing them. If you came to the pre-concert lecture, you heard a little bit more, but these are two pieces by Ravel, and Ravel was one of Vaughan Williams' most important teachers. So that's why he fits into the concert. We talked about it as like a birthday party, right? So we invited his friends too, right? Not just him. But anyway, I encourage you to keep your program open to read the words as they go along, because otherwise these songs might not make as much sense. One, because they're in French, but two, because they're written in the French chanson tradition where the music really tries to paint the picture of the text. So especially the second piece would sound kind of crazy unless you're really listening to or reading what the words are. So I just want to encourage you to do that as we go. So we hope you enjoy trois chansons, or two of the three songs by Ravel.
Thank you.
what you need to do, and we'll see you for the second half. Thank you.